From this lecture onward, we will start a new topic of power system protection. Now, to understand the importance of power system protection, we should try to understand some aspects of a power system. And these are majorly three aspects. What are those? First one is the normal operation of a power system. And in this, we usually do not assume any fault of any electrical equipment or fault due to any human error or any act of God. Okay, act of God means like thunder, etc. And it involves the design of system which should at least cater for supplying existing load and some of the anticipated future load. So it should at least have these minimum requirements. Okay, now since we design the system usually for normal operation as well as some contingencies also, so major portion of the expenses or the expenditure is ensuring the normal operation of the power system. Usually what we consider for normal operation, we try to find a choice between the type of generation we should utilize, like whether we should use hydro generation, thermal generation, solar generation or nuclear generation and other various means. We should also try to understand where to locate those generating plants. Now, once we have understood the choice of generation as well as their location, we should try to find the choice of the transmission of power from generating stations to the load. Now, once it is done, we should also try for provision of metering for various parameters of the power system like load delivered or the power generated and power delivered, losses, voltage and frequency, all those profiles. We should also monitor or have some provisions to monitor the power quality, which usually refers to the voltage and frequency on the major part. Okay, power quality also assumes for the various factors like total harmonic distortion and other factors. Now, the design for normal operation should also cater for the requirement of normal maintenance practices. That is, we should be able to do some normal maintenance or routine maintenance on the system without causing any disruption to the system or its normal operation. Now, there are two other aspects of a power system. What are those? We usually try that somehow we should be able to prevent any electrical failure of the system. Okay. And how do we do that? We either increase the reliability of the system by using some redundancy and other factors, or improving the design of the various equipment. And we can also improve the design of the equipment like by increasing the insulation level of various equipment, improving the insulation coordination between various devices of the system, and like provision of overhead ground wires on the transmission line, and provision of improved mechanical structure of the equipment involved in the various parts of the power system. However, there is a limit to it. Why? Because ultimately, the economics will come into the picture. And the returns which we are going to get with every added penny which we put into the system will be lower or will be diminished. That is the law of diminishing returns. What does it mean? That after a certain limit, the amount of return which we are going to get by inputting a given amount will be reduced. Okay. So the economy will come into the picture, and we cannot design a foolproof system which is having total prevention of electrical failure. Okay. There can be failure due to even human errors also. Okay. Now, let us say electrical failure has happened because we cannot design a foolproof system. So, what should we try to do? We should try to mitigate the various harmful effects of the electrical fault. Usually, we try to consider the short circuits and their harmful effect. And very small consideration is also given to the unwanted high voltage phenomena also. Okay. So, what should we try to do for mitigating the harmful effects of the electrical failure? We should design our system like we should have current limiting impedances like reactors and the neutral grounding resistors. We should also try that the generation plant are not concentrated at one place so that the fault level is reduced. However, in modern times, we have super generating stations. So, it is actually not pretty much unavoidable. Okay. And we should also try to design the system that such that even if some short circuit happens, it should withstand the effect of those short circuit currents. Okay. So, this is the philosophy of the design part to mitigate the effect of electrical failure. Now, the importance or the part comes for the protective relays. What they should do? They should try to promptly disconnect the faulty element by sensing and sensing the fault and giving appropriate signal to appropriate circuit breakers, etc. And we can also further mitigate the harmful effects of these faults if we somehow remove the faulty element and reclose the system fast enough such that the stability is also improved. Okay, like we can increase the redundancy, we can put alternate equipment in place of the faulty equipment. We can also implement auto reclosing facility in the circuit breaker system. Now there are various other equipment also like automatic voltage regulators which are there in the generating station to control the voltage being generated at the plant. These are usually always working. Whenever there is some change in the voltage profile, they will automatically actuate. Now, one of the most important part is the proactive observation of the various parameters of the power system. A proactive observation can also help to, you know, prevent various electrical faults just by seeing the condition of various parameters. Okay, by experience, we can easily find that this equipment is going to fail over this point of time by just observing its, you know, various characteristics and behaviors. Now, you see, even though the protective relays are coming up to this point only, however, their importance is pretty much high in the whole part of the power system. We will further see in our, you know, later lectures that all these requirements of mitigation of harmful electrical effects of the electrical failures are interdependent. Okay, so if the relays do not function properly, many of these characteristics or the factors, considerations will get affected because of improper working of the protective relaying equipment. Okay, so even if this point is just one point, it carries the weight of all other points. So in this way, we can see that protective relaying is a very fundamental and important aspect of power system. Now, in the next slide, we will see the basic functioning of protective relaying, and we will also try to understand some basic philosophies of the protective relaying. The fundamental function of protective relaying is to identify and isolate as fast as possible the faulty element or the faulty part of the system, of the power system. Okay, and a secondary function of the protective system or the protective relaying can be the at least approximate location of the fault so that we can easily eliminate the fault and we can easily attend to the faulty condition, and as soon as possible we can also try to, you know, recontinue the supply. Okay, now these are some of the, you know, qualities of or the desired qualities of protective relaying system. Okay, what are those? The sensitivity should be very high, that is, the protective relaying should be able to sense or identify the fault. That is, it should get activated or start activating as fast as possible. Okay. What is the meaning of selectivity? You know, there will be a trade-off between all of these qualities or the desired qualities. Why? Because many of these qualities are, you know, kind of contradicting with each other. Like, if I make some system very sensitive, then it will be prone to, you know, fault tripping also. So, there will be a reduced selectivity. But we also want that the protective system should be selective enough so that fault tripping should not be there. That is, a relay should know when it should activate or when it should give some command to trip the circuit breaker. That is, like in this system, if this relay has to sense only the fault in this zone, then it should operate only if the fault is in this zone. It should not operate for the fault in this zone before the operation of relay number 10, relay at the circuit breaker number 10. Otherwise, what will happen? It will lead to disconnection of a major portion of the power system. Okay. Now, the protective relaying should have very high speed. Again, this will be a contradicting quality requirement with the sensitivity as well as selectivity. As far as the modern relays are concerned, numerical relays are concerned, there is some given sampling frequency. So, sometimes there will be a very minimum requirement of the operating time. However, that operating time is usually, you know, negligible as compared to other operating time of the various equipment like circuit breaker and all those. But still, the speed is again having some contradiction with other required qualities. Now, it is observed that the power delivery of a power system to a load and the time of isolation of the fault follows this graph which I am trying to draw here. Let us say we want to discuss line to ground faults. The graph is like this. The higher the time of isolation or time taken to isolate the faulty equipment, lower will be the power delivery capability. This is for the line to ground fault. Okay. Now, similarly, for line to line fault, some kind of this graph is there. Now, for double line to ground fault, this graph is further deteriorated. And for line to line or the three phase symmetrical short circuit fault, the graph is further deteriorated. So you see that the speed is a very important requirement for the protective system so that the power delivery can be having some, you know, good value and the system is stable. Okay. Now, as I already told that the system should be reliable. Now, what is the definition of reliability? Usually, it should be known to everybody. It is the probability of a system that it will be doing its intended or the required function at a given point of time. That is, the system should be doing its required function and the probability that it is doing that function should be high. Okay. That now, how can we improve the reliability? One part is the improvement of the redundancy. Okay. Second part is the improvement in the design. And third part is the improvement in the relay settings and their coordination. So, we can improve the reliability of the system by various factors. Okay. Now, here in this figure, I have tried to show some fundamental principles of protection system. Okay. What are those? Usually, we classify in two broad parts. First one is the primary protection or the primary relaying, and the second one is the backup protection or the backup relaying. Now, as of now, I'm not going to tell you how do we demarcate the boundaries of these zones. We will study this later in upcoming lectures, but we should know that we try to demarcate various parts of the power system in various small zones, so that when a fault occurs, the isolation of a only small part is required. Okay, instead of isolation of the full power system, only small part of that zone is possible. That's why we try to isolate or demarcate the power system in various zones. Okay, now usually the zone is lying near the circuit breaker, or actually it is the current transformer. Okay, wherever the CT is present or the circuit breaker is present, we try to draw the zone. Okay, so that the amount or the part of power system which is going to be isolated is reduced. Okay, that we will explain further in detail. Okay, now here again I have tried to show that this is, let us say, generation. These are circuit breakers 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 15, and I have divided them in zone A, B, C, D, E, F, G, G dash, E dash, D dash, and others. Okay, now what I'm trying to show here is that the zones are overlapping with each other. Like zone A is having overlap with zone B boundary. Similarly, zone A dash is having overlap with zone B dash boundary. Why is it so? We try to have overlaps between various zones or the various boundaries so that no part of the power system is unattended or unprotected. Like, let us say, if this is a circuit breaker, okay, and this is bus bar, this is bus coupler, circuit breaker, and this is again some circuit breaker to transmission line. Okay, now let us say this is zone A, and now I do not have, let us say, any overlapping in the boundaries of zone B and zone A, then we can see that this part of the power system is not protected by any of the protective relay. Okay, so the fault in this part will not be attended to, and this is a very critical scenario. Experience has shown that the cost of having overlaps is smaller as compared to the loss which we can have if some part of the power system is left unattended. At least it should have some kind of backup protection if it is not having some primary protection. Okay, now we will try to understand what is primary and backup protection in a little bit later, okay, in this same lecture. Okay, now let us say I do not put the boundary of the zone on the circuit breaker, then what will happen? Let us see that scenario also. Let us say this is a circuit breaker. Now, this is, let us say, some zone of protection, let us say zone B, and now let us say I have another zone which is not going or overlapping with the circuit breaker. So let us say the zones are having overlap, that is, no portion is, you know, unattended or unprotected, but still this zone A, let us say, is not passing through the circuit breaker, then what will happen? Then let us say power flow is in this direction, okay? Then any fault in this place will be isolated by this circuit breaker, or the relays will identify and the circuit breaker will trip and isolate the fault, okay? Now the fault here again can be isolated by the circuit breaker, since it is in the overlap of the zone A as well as zone B. So the zone B relays will sense and the circuit breaker will trip. Now let us say the fault is in just zone A. Now there is nothing to isolate this, okay? So somehow the relays at this point should be able to trip some other circuit breaker in this zone, okay? And since these should trip, then there will be some additional requirement on the relays for measurement and other parts, or for other communication. And if communication is not possible, then the relays will also give tripping signal to this circuit breaker as well as this circuit breaker. Then we can see that the portion which is going to be isolated in this case will be larger as compared to the scenario if this zone was passing over the circuit breaker. So that's why we try to draw the boundary of the zones on the circuit breaker, okay? Now let us try to understand what is primary relaying and what is backup relaying. Now this zone is having various circuit breakers. Each zone is kind of primary protection for that zone, okay? So that is, each breaker is kind of primary protection for that given zone. Like breaker 2 is primary protection for zone A dash, the relaying equipment and the circuit breaker 1 is the primary protection for zone A. Similarly, this zone B, breaker number 1, 3, 4 and associated relays and other equipment are the primary protection for zone B. Similarly, this is for zone B dash, okay? Now, if there is any fault, let us say, in this portion, that is, the fault is on the bus bar, okay? Or we can clearly see that this fault is in zone B dash. So what will happen? All the circuit breakers of zone B dash will trip simultaneously. Breaker number 2 will trip, 5 will trip and 3 will trip. So you can see, then when these breakers will trip, what will happen? You can clearly see that this part is isolated and this fault is isolated, okay? Now let me again draw the circuit breakers. Now this is the primary relaying, that all the circuit breakers in the given zone trips. Now let us say the fault is in the transmission line, okay, and somehow there is some fault in either the, let us say, CT, PT or some other DC supply of the relays or other equipment, such that the relay fails to trip at 9. That is, this zone E relays, or at least relay at circuit breaker 9, fails to trip the circuit breaker number 9. Okay, so what will happen? Let us say it gets tripped. Okay, so from this side it is isolated. If some generation is there, there will be no feeding to the fault from this side, but still this side will feed the fault. So what we will do, we will set the protection system of breakers of protection system at breaker number 4 and 5 or 4 and 3 such that if there is some failure in the operation of circuit breaker at 9, then after some lag, time lag, the breakers at 4 and 3 should trip. Okay. Now, what will we achieve from this? We can see then that when breaker number 4, 3, 4 tripped, and when this 4, 3 is tripped, 2 is also tripped, and 5 is also tripped, and 1 is also tripped. Okay. Now, you can clearly see that what is happening. This portion, this whole portion of the power system is getting isolated, and this fault is getting cleared. Okay. But due to this, we can see that even though we have isolated the fault, but the part of the power system which was isolated, it was very large. Actually, everything was isolated in this case. Okay, so you can see that however we achieved the isolation of faulty equipment, but the number of equipment which were isolated was very large. Okay, so this is the philosophy of backup relaying, that what we want to achieve is that there should be some kind of geographical isolation of the backup relaying system with the main relaying system, such that any kind of failure which has caused failure of activation of the protection system at this location should not hamper the ability of activation of the various protection system at this location or the backup location. Like, let us see if this is, there is some DC supply failure for the relaying equipment at this part. Then, since there is geographical location, this is some other station, then the probability that the DC component, DC supply is working is very high for this substation. So, these relays will trip the circuit, the corresponding circuit breakers. Okay, so for the backup relaying, what we want to achieve, that it should not fail to trip when the primary relaying fails to trip. That is, the probability of their functioning should be very high on the failure of this relaying. Okay, now to achieve this, what we are losing, we are losing the higher number of equipment in terms of isolation. But what we are achieving? We are achieving that we are having a lesser probability of same kind of failures at various locations. But practically, it may not be possible that every time we have such a very good scenario that we can have backup relaying at remote locations. So what we try to do? We either try to make redundancies. That is, we have multiple relays for the same kind of operation, or for the measurement part, we have multi-core CTs. Okay. However, PTs are usually not multi-core because of the cost and the size requirement, or the conditions imposed because of the size and cost on the PTs. However, multi-core CTs are still used in the power system. Okay. So, if we can somehow increase the redundancy of various systems at a given place, then somehow we can still manage backup relaying at the same geographical location. But the best possible scenario is still having a backup relaying at the remote locations for a given system. Okay. Since, let us say, if there is some failure in this breaker only, then we cannot have a redundant breaker in its place. Okay. Then we should always rely on the backup relaying at the remote point. Okay. Now, in the next slide, what we will do, we will try to solve a very conceptual example, which we will clear the concept of primary and backup protection. Okay. Now, there is one more point. We can compare the protective relaying of the power system to the insurance, which is usually very common nowadays. Okay, like insurance helps to, you know, mitigate. However, it does not mitigate the actual thing, but what it does, it ensures that we somehow mitigate the harmful effect of the bad condition or bad incident which has happened. Okay, so in that same way, protective relaying at least helps us to mitigate the bad effects of the fault, as same as that of insurance. But it is still different from insurance because it also tries to, you know, tell us the indication of location of fault and other factors. Okay, now let us see the numerical example in the next slide. Now here I have shown a power system. It's a single line diagram which is showing three generators. This is generator, this generator, and that generator. Okay, and eight circuit breakers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, now it is told that these are six cases of fault, A, B, C, D, E, and F. Now it is given that there is some maloperation or non-operations of some circuit breaker in some of the cases, and in some cases there is no maloperation or misoperation of the circuit breakers. Okay, now it is told that in this case A, breakers 4, 5, 8 have been tripped. In case B, 3, 7, 8 have been tripped. In case C, 3, 4, 5, 6 have been tripped. D, 1, 4, 5, 6 tripped. In case E, 4, 5, 7, 8 tripped. And in case F, 4, 5, 6 breakers tripped. Okay, now what we are asked? We are asked to find the exact location of the faults in these six scenarios. And we are also asked to demarcate the various zones of protection in this given power system. Now, how to proceed with this kind of example? What we will do? We will try to first demarcate various zones according to the principles which we have just seen in the previous slides. Okay. Now, we will demarcate the zones. The first zone for the circuit breaker and the generator will be like this. Okay, now this transmission line will be protected and the zone will be like this, and there will be overlapping also. Now this bus bar will have a protection and overlapping like this. Now this line between 3 and 4 will have a protection and overlapping like this. Now the bus bars and or the HV switch gear will have overlap and protection, zone protection like this. Okay, now this is going to have zone of protection like this. Now for the generators, the zone of protection and overlapping will be like this. Now, after drawing of this kind of scenario for the various zones of protection, now we can clearly see in which case there was some maloperation and in which case there was no maloperation and everything worked perfectly. And we can also find the exact location of the fault. Okay. Now, before proceeding further, I should tell you that the zones here I have shown as closed ones. Okay. In various parts of the power system, these can be open also. That is, their reach or the boundary can vary according to the operating conditions. Like in the last slide, in the last or the bottom of the slide, what I have shown, two loads like this. Okay, and these zones were shown as open. That is, their boundary was not closed and this was going to vary according to the operating conditions of the system. Okay. Now, there is one more beautiful thing which we should see, that even though there are faults on the power system, but the nature has given us ways and means to detect and isolate those. Okay. By just seeing or observing very few parameters of the power system, like the voltage and currents, power and the flow of power and its direction, change in frequency and rate of change of frequency. These are very, very small number of parameters which we need to observe to find and isolate the fault. Okay, so nature has given us ways and means to isolate and find the faults. Okay, even if there are faults because of nature, but still it has given us a way out of that. Okay, now let us proceed with the case number A. What it is saying? It is saying that breaker number 458 tripped. Okay, that is, this breaker got tripped. This breaker got tripped. And breaker number 8 got tripped. Let me see whether I have numbered them correctly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. Now, let us see what is the scenario. You see that breaker number 4, 5, 8 got tripped. Now, you can see that breaker number 4 and 5 are lying in one zone. In this zone of the protection of this HV switch gear or the bus bar. Okay. Now, if the breakers, all the breakers in this zone had activated, then 6 should have also tripped. Then either this has maloperated or there is some other kind of fault. Okay, but since we are given that there can be only one maloperation in the whole scenario for this case A, let us assume that 6 failed to trip. Okay, so you can see, according to the principles of backup relaying, the backup for breaker number 6 will be breaker number 8, as it is geographically located at other place and it is in the same line of the power flow. Okay, so you see that if there was fault at this point A, or let us say at this point on the bus bar, that is, the fault was on this bus bar, then if breaker number 6 maloperated or it did not operate, then breaker number 4 is okay to connect, to operate, 5 is also okay to operate, and 8 is also okay to operate. Okay, so in this case we can see that the fault location is the HV bus bar comprising of zone 4, 5, 6, and the breaker number 6 did not operate. And breaker number 8 operated as backup protection to breaker number 6. Okay, now let us again draw the circuit breakers and see the next scenario. Now, what are we told? That breaker number 3, 7 and 8 got tripped. Okay. So, you see, breaker number 3, 7 and 8 are not having any interlink. Okay. So, breaker number 3 tripped. So, either there was fault in this zone of protection of the transmission line, or there was a fault on this bus bar. Okay, now if there was fault on bus bar, then 2 would have also tripped, but 2 did not trip. So as we already told that the breakers tripped correctly, but some of the breakers might have not operated or maloperated. Okay, so breaker number 3 is tripped and 7 and 8 are also tripped. Then you can clearly see that somehow breaker number 4 did not operate. So, there was some fault on the transmission line or on in this zone, okay, for which 3 and 4 should have tripped, but 4 did not trip. So for its backup, 7 and 8 got tripped. Okay, so we can clearly see that 4 did not operate. And 7 and 8 operated as backup. And the fault was on the transmission line between breaker number 3 and 4. Okay. Now let us see the next case. The case number C. 3, 4, 5, 6. So, let us see what is the scenario. Breaker number 3 got tripped. 4 got tripped, 5 got tripped, and 6 got tripped. Now you see that 4, 5, 6 will trip if there is a fault on the bus bar, that is in this zone. Okay, but 3 will also trip with 4 if there is the fault in the zone of protection of this transmission line. So we can clearly see that fault will be in the overlap of these two zones, that is, this transmission line zone and this bus bar zone are overlapping, and the fault is here. Because of this, breaker number 3 and 4 also tripped, and 4, 5, 6 also got tripped. So, no maloperation or non-operation, and everything is perfect. Okay, for the case number C. Now, let us see for case number D. Let me erase this. One, four, five, six. This got tripped. Four got tripped. Five got tripped. And six got tripped. How is it possible? It is possible if there was a fault either here or here. Okay. So the fault can be in this place, so that 2, 3 should have been tripped, but 2, 3 is not there. So, I am not taking the overlap case. So, let us say fault was between breaker 1 and 2, and this breaker 2 did not operate. So, when 2 did not operate, the backup protection 4, 5, 6, which is at the remote location, operated. So, 2 did not operate. And 4, 5, 6 operated as backup. Okay, now let us see the next case. Breaker number 4, 5, 7, 8 got tripped. Now, you see, 4 got tripped, 5 got tripped, 7 got tripped, and 8 also got tripped. 8 also was tripped. Now let us see where is the fault. This is tripped, this is tripped, this is also tripped. Okay, and it is also tripped. What can be the scenario? Let us see. If the fault was in just this zone, okay, then 3 would have also tripped. Okay, clearly the fault is not in this zone. Now, if fault was in this zone, then 5 and 7 has tripped. So, it would have been isolated. Okay, so where the fault is? The fault is in the overlap, in which somehow this 6 number did not operate. Sorry, not in the overlap. The fault is here. E. So let us say if the fault is here and 6 did not operate, then 4 operated, 5 operated, 7 operated, and 8 operated. Okay. Or you can see that fault can even be in the overlap also. There is no just hard and fast rule. If the fault is here, then again the scenario will be similar. See, 6 did not trip, 4, 5. So to back up this, 8 also tripped and 7 also tripped. But this is the safer one, more appropriate one. So we can see that for this, 6 did not operate and 4, 5, 7 operated as backup. Okay. Now, let me see the next case. 4, 5, 6. 4, 5, 6. Now, it is the easiest one. 4, 5, 6 tripped. It means the fault was here and all the breakers tripped. No maloperation. Now, you see, let us again try to see E part. Okay. Let us try to take some other fault position or the fault location instead of these two and try to again visualize whether that fault location is more appropriate. Now, in my own solution which I did myself, I have drawn that the fault was in this place. Let us see what is the scenario now for the case number E. Okay. So, the fault was in this. Okay. So, you can see when the fault was here, it was in the overlapping zone. So, 4, 5, 6 should have tripped. And 5 and 7 should also have tripped because of this transmission line zone protection. Okay. But we are told that 6 is not tripped. Okay. So when 6 is not tripped, for this should be the backup. Okay. So 8 got tripped. So I think that this is the more appropriate fault location and 6 did not operate and just 8 operated as backup. Now this is the more appropriate one as compared to the previous which I discussed. Now you can clearly see that when E is at this point, then 5 and 7 should have operated, 4, 5, 6 should have operated, but 6 did not operate, so 8 operated as backup protection. So this is more appropriate location for the fault. Okay. So in this way, we can try to formulate various zones of protection. Okay. For primary protection, and we can also try to identify various backup protection and the location of fault according to the given conditions. Now, in upcoming lectures, we will try to formulate some rules for determining these zones of protection and the settings for the backup protection also. That we will do in the upcoming lectures when we will study various kind of relays, their protection functions, their settings in detail. Okay. Now this is a little bit theoretical only, but this is the just beginning of the very important and very, you know, in-depth study of protection system for the power system. Now I should tell you that I am following 2-3 books. The first book is The Art and Science of Protective Relaying. Art and Science of Protective Relaying. By C.R. Mason, C. Russell Mason. Now this book is very old book, but the basic concepts are still the same. Only little bit have changed in the concepts being used, like backup protection as of now in numerical relays is usually not being done for the remote locations. we are giving redundancy in various equipment. Okay, so some of things have just changed, however the basic principles are still the same. So this book, even though it is old, it is very good book. Now it is clearly trying to show that this protective relaying is an art as well as science. Science because it is following some fundamental rules. And what is, why it is art? Because higher the experience of the person doing the various set, relay settings and various studies of the relay, better he will be able to have good coordination between various parts of the various relays of the power system. And the better the coordination, there will be better discrimination between the operation of these relays. So this is the art part, the experience with which the individual will get, you know, a competency in the relay part, and science because it is still following only some fundamental rules. Okay, this is the first book which I am following. The second book will be the NPAG, Network Protection, and I don't actually remember the full form. NPAG by Alstom, or as of now it is by GE. Okay. Third book is by Arun G. Fadke. And on an overall summary for this syllabus, I am following D.P. Kothari and Nagrath. Okay. And for some of the topics, I am also following Badri Ram. Okay, so these are some books which I am trying to following in the study of the power system protection. We will have a very in-depth coverage of this subject or this part of the top subject, so that everybody is you know, confident enough in this part of the power system, since it is usually not available in other domains, or it is not freely available. So if you find that this lecture is helpful to you, then please share and subscribe my YouTube channel. Thank you.